this book of Psalms is such a prophetic book in its nature. And really, we've been hearing and catching a glimpse of the life of David and starting this psalm, and just been a very personal and intimate setting with him. And to be quite honest with you, there's been such a struggle that he's been facing and enduring, going through this, and just been so eye-opening and heart-rendering, just to be able to catch a glimpse of what's been going on in David's life. But tonight, the title of the message is Christ, the Sufficient One. And this is really about who we are in Christ and also about what we possess in Him. And so I'm delighted to be able to share that with you. And I believe this will just be such a great encouragement to your spirit and gaining a great insight on what David has to say and how the Lord was at work in his life. And really just a declaration of thanksgiving and praise that David had in his life. And so before we jump in into Psalm 18, can we go to the Lord in prayer? Can we do that together? Father, we love you and we thank you for our time together tonight in your word. We know that your word does not return void. And so God, I pray that you use this messenger with your message. And what I have to say does not matter, but what you have to say is life-giving. It's the only thing that matters. And so, God, I pray that you will help us tonight to be spirit-filled listeners. The God, that we will listen intently and on purpose. And God, that you will help us to grow in our relationship with you and realize the greatness of you and who you are and what you are and what you are to us and how you want to live your life through us. We have such a great, Lord, a life that is so focused and built around you, and there's power and there's encouragement and there's nurturing and there's fulfillment and joy as we yield to the presence of God in us. And so God, I just pray that we will do that. I pray that we will just gain from your strength, your knowledge, and God, that we'll do just that tonight, grow in the wisdom and knowledge of you. Lord, I pray for the service that we had this morning and the decisions that were made and spiritually. And God, I pray that people will desire to live under you and that the gospel will motivate them to live differently and to impact the lives of others as you have impacted their life. And I pray that we will be a unified church, and God, that we will have a heart of oneness for each other, and a heart of encouragement and a heart of fellowship, but a heart that is driven with the same calls, and that is to reach the lost and to reach the world for Jesus Christ. And so God, I just pray that tonight that we'll just see how sufficient you are for us. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Have you ever felt like or been in a situation? Have you ever been at a place in your life where it looked like maybe it just wasn't going to end well? You ever been there? You ever been at a place in your life where it just seemed like, I'm just not so sure this is going to have a great outcome? Have you ever been at a place or a situation in your life where it looked like there was no way out? Well, if you've ever been there, regardless of how small or how big, David in Psalm 18 had been at that place. And this is the situation that we find David here in. As Psalm 18, I don't know if you're there in your Bible, hopefully you are. If you are there, you'll notice this is 50 verses long. This is a long psalm, and so we're not going to cover this tonight, but this is a long psalm for us to jump into. But however, David had experienced some great deliverance from God. He had experienced a great deliverance from some difficult times in his life, and he was delivered by the Lord, and we get to see that and have a small glimpse of that from David. I'd like for you to look at Psalm 18 and look at verses 6 and 7 to begin with, and we'll be all around. We will go back to verse 1 and start there, but for the moment, look at verse 6 and 7. In my distress, I called upon the Lord and cried unto my God. He heard my voice. Isn't that good news, church? That you cried out to the Lord, and guess what? He heard you. Amen? That's good news. Hello? Is anyone home? See, that's not good news when you call and 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 no one answers. Man, I can't get through. Man, it's an emergency. And David said, in my distress. It wasn't good. It was bad. But when I called, man, he heard me. And I love that. But notice this, verse 6. He heard my voice out of his temple, and my cry came before him. Boy, it got right to God. Even into his ears. You ever been talking to someone? Man, I'm telling you. They're standing right in front of you, and the lights are on, but no one's home. Can I hear an amen right there? And David said, boy, this got right into the ears of my God. Look at verse 7. Then the earth shook and trembled. The foundations also of the hills moved and were shaken because he was wroth. God got angry. He got angry of what David had experienced. What David felt anger over and what David had been distressed by also moved God as well. That ought to encourage you tonight, knowing that when you are moved and what bothers you bothers the Lord. Man, God is so intimately close with you that what affects you affects our God. And I'd like for you to jump to verse 16 through 19, Psalm 18. Go to verse 16. He sent from above. He took me. He drew me out of many waters. He delivered me from the strong enemy and from them which hated me. They were too strong for me. They prevented me in the day of my calamity, but the Lord was my stay. Man, he was unmovable. He was unshakable. Man, when the waters were turbulent, God was steady. Verse 19. He brought me forth also into a large place. He delivered me because he delighted in me. Boy, David had experienced great deliverance, and I'm thankful that we just don't see the bad in David's life, which we've kind of been experiencing along this journey. Man, it's just one thing after another thing that just seems kind of, it's just kind of bad over and over and over. And like, man, this guy can't catch a break. But then we notice David says, you know what? Out of it all, man, God delivered me, and he heard me, and God is with me, and God is for me, and I want to give you a little bit of background here. This psalm is a psalm of victory. I want you to get that. And I want you to understand that in your heart tonight. Yes, there are some difficult times, but this is a psalm of victory after David's deliverance. And he's just praising and singing to God. He's singing unto the Lord for his deliverance. And I want you to understand on the screen, it is clear as you read this psalm that David is a picture of his seed, which is Israel, in the last days that will gain a great deliverance. And you can look at verse 50 and see that. Great deliverance giveth he to his king, and showeth mercy to his anointed, to David, and to his seed forevermore. Folks, there's no doubt that David is talking about end times and talking about a day yet to come. And this is a fascinating psalm. And I've already said that this is a prophetic book in its nature. And it's dealing with the last days and the day of the Lord and his second coming as Christ comes to earth. It is a prophetic psalm, but that's not the direction I want to go. I want to go tonight with you and explain to you and help us to gain an appreciation some very practical things from this psalm. And that is that David found some incredible things about the Lord that I believe will be helpful to you and I. And I believe it'll be an encouragement to you and I in our everyday life as well. And as David went through his incredible trial, he found that the Lord was his all-sufficient one. Look at verses 1 through 3. May we back up to Psalm 18 and cover verses 1 through 3 now. Now I want you to notice what David expresses here about the sufficiency of Christ. I will love thee, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my, what's that, church? He is my rock and my what? Fortress and my deliverer. Man, what a blessing. My God, my strength, in whom I will trust. He's my buckler and the horn of my salvation and my high tower. Woo, that's a good list right there. I mean, David is laying it on thick, man. He is expressing who God is. Boy, that is some good description of our God. I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies. How do you know? He just described him in verses 1 and 2. It doesn't get any better than that. And David is expressing to you and I how Christ is so sufficient. Did you know that the Bible declares our Savior Jesus Christ? Did you know he is described as the Lord of Lords? He is described as the Lord, capital L-O-R-D. He's the Lord of little L-O-R-D. He's the Lord of Lords. Do you remember that Thomas worshipped him? The Bible says that when he worshipped him, he said, "My Lord and my God." Jesus Christ was Jehovah God manifested in the flesh. Jesus said in John 8:58, "Before Abraham was, I am." Man, that's good news. Why? Whatever you have in Christ, you have in God, and it's enough. Everyone say, it's enough. God's enough. He's enough for our every need. If you've ever believed on Christ as your Lord and Savior, Colossians 2, 9 and 10 says this, "For in Him, Christ, dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and ye are complete in Him." Can we say that last sentence, "and ye are complete in Him," together? Ready to begin. "And ye are complete in Him." And you, because of who He is, because of His sufficiency, because in Him is all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, because of who He is, you are complete. Not because of who you are. You're not complete in yourself. You are complete in Christ. Do you know what that word complete means? Sufficient. It's enough. What you have in you, Jesus Christ, is enough for your every need. Through faith in Christ, you were placed in Him, and you were given Christ's very life the moment that you trusted Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Can you imagine that? Can you just fathom that for a moment? Can you just embrace that for a moment right now? Can you just kind of take that into your heart right now and refresh your thoughts? How when you were saved, that Christ took all your sins and washed it white as snow, and He took all your sin and removed it from the east as far as the west. He chose to remember it no more, and He removed that from your life and no longer looks at you as a sinner, but sees you before the holy God, our Father, as a saint in Christ. Wow! That's amazing. Because we don't look at each other like that. We still have carnality and carnal eyes. But when God sees you through His Son, He sees the sufficiency and the completeness of His Son in you. Whoa, that's good. Because Aubrey, you don't look all that good. But God looks at you through Jesus and goes, "Man, that guy's all right. He's okay. He's my child. And what I have in him, I'm satisfied with." Well, that's good news for you and I. See, all that you need to live victoriously is found in Christ. You lack nothing. All that you need to live victoriously in this life is Jesus Christ. See, our position of completeness in Christ does not automatically guarantee us victory. See, Pastor, you just said, "I lack nothing." That is true. You said that what's in me is sufficient, and that sufficiency is Jesus Christ, and that's very true. You just said that my victory is found in Christ Jesus. That's very true. I just want you to know, though, just because you have the completeness of Christ in you does not automatically guarantee you victory every moment of your life. Say, then what is it? Here it is. However, you and I must know how to use what we have been given in Christ. And my concern is that's where most Christians fail, is they're not sure how to use what Christ has given them in the Lord. Now, the fact is that somebody could come and give me a radio, and I like music. I'm a big fan of music, and somebody could come and give me a music box. I think back in the day they used to call them boom boxes. Remember when people used to carry them on their shoulders? That was so stupid, wasn't it? I mean, 14D batteries in it. I mean, it played for 20 minutes and it was dead. I mean, huge. I mean, big old speakers. And of course, people were dancing and break dancing, all that stuff. Boxes this big. I mean, you know, that thing weighed probably 40 pounds. But it had every gadget on it. And, it has a tuner. And some of you probably don't even know this. Some of you young people. A cassette deck. How many of you know what a cassette deck is? Yeah. How many of you know what an 8-track is? Look. Zach and Christy, you guys don't even know what an 8-track is. Babies. You haven't lived till you had an 8-track, man. I'm going to confess my faults before you right now. Growing up in high school, my mom and dad bought me a stereo. And every guy wants a stereo in his room. But my mom and dad bought a stereo that had an 8-track in it. I didn't invite anybody over. It was so embarrassing. But this 8-track thing, here's the thing. They gave me some of their 8-tracks. I'm talking about, like, I'm not even going to tell you some of the names of the 8-tracks. They were just bad. Just terrible music. To them, it was great. To me, I was like, I can't believe you guys are actually wanting me to listen to this. But they came out with this gadget where you could put a cassette in this contraption. You could put it in your 8-track. Now, here's the thing. You could play it and you could fast forward it, but you couldn't rewind it. So when you set it in motion, you either had to go all the way through it and fast forward it. But if you got a song you liked or missed, guess what? You had to sit the entire thing to get back to the beginning. Point is this, is that someone could give me a radio and I could appreciate that, and then I could say, hey, listen, it says that it plays CDs and I like CDs, but I can't get the CD to work. Look, I've opened the lid and I put the CD in there, and man, I'm hitting play and nothing's happening. And then that person could come over and said, Pastor Larry, there's a switch on the side that says AM, FM, then it says CD player. You have to go from the radio to the CD player. So no matter how you put the CD in it, no matter how many times you hit the play button, if you don't go over here and hit the switch on the boombox or the radio, it doesn't tell it to play the CD. How many are with me right there, all right? So here's my point of this statement. Doesn't matter what you have. It could be the greatest boombox. It could have all the gadgets and all the bells and whistles. But if you don't know how to use it, then how good will it be to you? It won't be good to you at all. It won't help you at all. And for the longest time, on our van, I couldn't find the defrost on our van. The windows would keep fogging up in the back and the front, and I could not find the defrost on our van. I'm so used to it was right there where the normal gadgets are, and my vehicle, it's rotor dial, man. You have to switch this thing over to it where it. And on this, on our van, it's push button, but the defrost, the front and the back, are not with the instruments that drive the air conditioned heater. It's two buttons that are all by themselves. For the life of me, I couldn't find them buttons. And I got so mad at that thing, I'm like, I called Honda, I'm like, what kind of van? It won't defrost the windows. And they're like, Mr. Luffman, the windows do defrost. I'm like, I've put it on every setting. that the unit provides, every setting. I said, and I punched all through it, and it puts it on feet, head, body, and feet. But there's no defrost at all on that setting. And they said, Mr. Luffman, it's a total button all by itself. I felt like a moron. It was two buttons that had nothing to do with it, that you pushed. They were all separate, and they ran it on its own thing and controlled its own environment, so it was immediately defrost. I didn't know. It was there the whole time, and I didn't know. The point is, it goes back to this. You and I must know how to use what we've been given in Christ. If you want total victory, then that's why it's so important that you and I become students of the Bible. That's why it's so important for you and I to learn what God has to say. See, the problem isn't with that van setting, the defrost and all that. It wasn't with the radio. The problem is with my understanding of how to use it. It was there the whole time, and I didn't know how to use it. So how do you and I learn how to use what we've been given in Christ? How do we do that? How do we learn, or how do we use what we've been given in Jesus Christ? How do we do that? It's very simple. We do it through God's Word. That's how we do it. And we've got to learn how to use what God's given us, and He's given us His book. He's given us this instruction manual, if you would, and I'm not trying to dumb this whole thing down, but this is what tells us and guides us into His truth and helps us to guide us into victory that Christ has for us. It reveals to you and I what we've been given and then how to use it. If you and I are saved, we have the power of Christ living within us, and I have God's instruction through His Word. I have His instruction on how to tap into it and use and appropriate the power that He's given to you and I. And as you read Psalm 18, what you find is, yeah, Jesus Christ is never mentioned by name. The name Jesus Christ, his physical name is never used. Yet, as a believer in Christ, you should see Christ all through the Scriptures. And He is, and you should see Christ all through the Psalm. And the entire book of the Bible is a book about Jesus Christ. It all points to Him. He is the focus and the central figure. Luke 24, verse 27 on the screen says, "And the beginning at Moses and all the prophets, He expounded unto them in all the Scriptures the things concerning Himself." Jesus was telling the disciples, "Hey guys, this whole thing's about me. What you've heard and what you've learned, even from Moses, even from the law, everything that's been expounded and given and passed down from prophets and from word of mouth, and even with me here with you presently and physically, this is about me. I am the central figure. I am the one that is sufficient for you. I am the one that provides hope. I am the one that provides strength." And you and I have an advantage, though, that the disciples and David did not have. You and I have the entire and completed Word of God. See, David did not have that. David had to many times look back on his circumstances to see all that the Lord was and all that the Lord is doing through His mighty power. But see, we don't have to look at circumstances. We don't have to try to understand circumstances and all of that to see God at work. See, we have all of that in Christ Jesus. We have God and His Word. We have the Bible. We have the holy written Word of God. We can clearly look into the Scriptures and see the sufficiency of God. See, God's Word has lifted the veil. We no longer see through glass that is darkly veiled. We don't look through glass that has fog on it. We have found where the button is, if you will, to lift the fog. We hold in our hands the completed Word of God. And the Bible gives us a full understanding of who we are in Christ and what we possess in Christ. That's why it's so important we go to the Bible. And I want us to look specifically at Psalm 18 and specifically verse 2 for tonight of Psalm 18. And so if you'd go to Psalm 18, I'd like for you to look at verse 2. And Miss Sandra, if you would come and make ready for this. While she is coming, look at Psalm 18. Look at verse 2. Wherever I lead off, I want you to finish. Would you do that? So let's practice this. I will leave off, and you say the word or words where I leave off. Here we go. The Lord is my and my and my my God, my strength, in whom I will trust, my and the horn of my salvation, and my. Hey, listen, that's your God. That's my God right there. And notice in verse 2, this will be the first thing that I want to share with you about Christ, the sufficient one, the complete one, who in him is complete, not lacking anything. Notice verse 2, David says, the Lord is my rock. And I want you to get that tonight, that Christ is our rock. David used this term rock several times in reference to the Lord. Keep a bookmarker in Psalm 18. Would you go to Psalm 40 and look at verse 2 very quickly. Psalm 40, verse 2. Boy, I like this verse. This is good right here. Such a reminder of where we came from and where we are. Notice verse 2, Psalm 42. He brought me up out of a horrible pit. How do you like that? Not just a pit. Not just, just kind of a hole, but a horrible pit. Out of the miry clay and set my feet upon a what, church? A rock. And established my goings. The idea is that God had lifted him up out of a mud hole. And he put his feet on some solid footing. I don't know if you've ever tried to climb up a slick embankment. I don't know if you've ever tried to climb up a grassy knoll, if you will. I don't know if you've ever tried to run up a hill that had red clay. And that red clay, man, I'll tell you, when that stuff gets wet, man, it's like trying to run on onion peels. You know what I'm saying? I mean, it's just as slick as it can be. There's just no traction. And David is saying that Jesus had laid a solid foundation. David has a solid foundation. And I want you to know that if you have a solid foundation, and that foundation is Jesus, he is your rock, you can build on that. You can't build on a bad foundation. And as we read God's word, we learn that this is exactly what Christ is to us. He's our solid foundation. How about 1 Corinthians 10:4? And did all drink the same spiritual drink? For they drank out of that or of that spiritual rock that followed them. And that rock was Christ. Let's say that together. Ready to begin. And that rock was Christ. That's right. He's my rock. He's my rock. He alone is my salvation. He is my foundation. Have you ever heard the hymn, In Christ Alone? Don't you love that song? I'd like for us to sing that song. And the words are going to come up on the screen, and it's next. And man, you talk about Christ being your sufficiency. You don't have to stand or do anything. We'll just sing it together. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, I mean, if that isn't the rock, I don't know what is. Man, we sing these songs, and these songs have such impact. And I'm going to tell you, I don't know if there's a better song to sing than that one tonight. As a refresher and a reminder that he is my sufficiency, Christ is my rock. In Christ alone, I don't need anything else. Christ alone. See, it's not just in Christ, it's Christ alone. See, it's not in Christ plus something. And boy, there's a lot of religions that will teach it's Christ plus something. It's works plus, you know, it's grace plus works. It's grace plus something else. And if you do this tradition, if you do this kind of jumping through the hoops, and if you follow the thing just like they want you to at the church, no, it's Christ alone. So let's sing that together, Miss Sandra. I love this song. And I want you to sing with me. We'll sing the whole song. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in, that's Christ alone. Here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry through final death, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of him, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I stand. Christ is your rock, folks. In Christ alone. Thank you, Miss Sandra. There is none other. He is it. He is who we have hope in. He is our fortress. And I love how that song just over and over, here in the love of Christ I stand. Here in the death of Christ I live. Here in the power of Christ I stand. It doesn't matter what man says. It's not, no matter what scheme of hell that comes up from the very pit of hell, no matter what scheme Satan can come up with, listen, no matter fashion or form that someone can manipulate, nothing will remove me from the love that is found in God. Nothing can pluck me from his hand. I love that about that song. See, Christ is our rock. He alone is the foundation that our entire life is built upon. And church, I need you to get that. I need you just to rest in on that. I need you not to be moved from that. I need you to be in that sedentary place that Christ alone is your rock. And the fact is, if your life is built upon anything other than your relationship with Jesus Christ, my friend, you have a shaky foundation. I want you to know that. By the way, a lot of Christians do that. A lot of people will build their relationship on maybe even their mother and father. I mean, My mom and dad went to church, so I go to church. Let me tell you something. You will grow tired of that, and you will not last long. You won't be faithful. Well, oh, my grandpa, he was a pastor. That's great, but I'm going to tell you, that won't get you into heaven. Well, I enjoy singing at the church, and I enjoy teaching at the church, and all those things are great, but what about your relationship with Jesus Christ? What are you building your life upon? Surely you're not building it upon what people think of you. Surely you're not building it upon how what others may congratulate you on or thank you for that you may do in the church or around the church or even for the church. Listen, those things are a bad foundation. Jesus Christ is your rock, and He's the only foundation that you and I should build our life upon. I love this verse, 1 Corinthians 3:11. For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is our foundation. Listen, if you build your life on feeling good, that's a shaky foundation. If you live just to make yourself feel good, I mean, boy, that's a Joel Osteen right there. Hey, you're so good, go out and buy yourself something. Make me want to vomit. That just puts people in debt, Joel. What's your problem? That doesn't help them. You're so good, go invest in yourself. Are you kidding? This isn't the kingdom. That's the last thing we need to do is invest in ourselves. Man, we need to invest in Jesus, and we need to invest in others. We surely don't need to elevate our platform of ourselves any higher. We've already built a God of our own self. Man, we need Jesus Christ. That's what we need. If you have built your life around money, that's a shaky foundation. If you've built your life around relationships or sports, man, it doesn't take you long to realize that the older you get, the fewer sports you're able to do. And your mind says, yes, go for it, but your body says, hold on a minute there. And, you know, the fact is that if you build your life on hobbies or education and or marriage and careers, let me tell you something, you got a shaky foundation. Say, Pastor, are you saying I shouldn't build my marriage? No, that's not what I said. What I said is that's not what you build your life on. Because there have been a lot of people that have come down the aisle for marriage, and then 6 months, six years or 16 years or whatever later, that marriage is resolved and they've built their whole life on this one individual. That individual left. Now what? That's the wrong foundation. See, people make the statement and they mean well. Well, he or she just completes me. Really? Well. No, I have to go back to Colossians 2:10 that says, and ye are complete in Him. So I got the thing wrong. My wife doesn't complete me. I don't complete her. We are in need of each other, and I'm thankful for that, and God put us together, and that's a wonderful thing. But let me tell you something. My wife is complete in Christ. I am not her sufficiency. Oh my goodness. If she's relying on that, she is poorly mistaken and will be poorly disappointed, and I'm sure there have been those times in her life. Surely not for me, of you, honey. But the fact is, that's not how it works. And people build their marriage and their careers and their relationships on those kind of foundations. My friend, that is a shaky foundation. No, you build your life on the rock, and that rock is Jesus Christ. He is our foundation. Do you know that old hymn, The Solid Rock? Do you know that song? My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is what? Sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Man, when darkness veils His lovely face, when it comes, the songwriter says, I rest on His unchanging grace. Well, that's good right there. In every high and stormy gale, I mean, they come. my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Boy, I'm so thankful for Christ, who is our solid rock. See, as I would agree with David here in Psalm 42, you're probably still there. Would you look once again at Psalm 40 and verse 2? Maybe you're still there. David said, he brought me up out of an horrible pit, out of the miry clay. And he set my feet upon a rock and established my goings. May I say to you tonight that Christ, if you are saved, if you're in Christ, that Christ also has lifted you from a mud hole. You were in the mud hole of sin. And Christ delivered you from that. He saved us, and we are rooted in Him. Would you look at Acts chapter 4, and then we'll go back to Psalm 18. But look at Acts chapter 4. I'd like for you to look at verses 11 and 12 with me. Acts chapter 4, verses 11 and 12. Acts 4, 11 and 12. Acts 4. This is the stone which was set at naught of you, builders, which has become the head of the corner. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Jesus is that rock. Jesus is the sure foundation. Jesus has made it very clear for us to understand, hey, want to be saved from the mud hole? Want to be saved from the horrible pit? Then Jesus is that rock. He is the rock that you and I are rooted and built on. You may be here tonight and feel like, hey, you know what? I feel like I'm kind of sinking. You may feel like there have been times in your life where you've been drowning in a sea of difficult circumstances. Maybe you've had your lot. Maybe you feel like, man, it just seems to be overwhelming for me. It just seems like I can't catch a break. I've heard that before. Sometimes I've felt that way. Just feels like the waves are coming over, and it just feels like, man, I've had all I can take. This is when you must go. This is when you must go to God's Word, and you must realize, and you must say this, no. I am not sinking. I feel like I'm sinking. I feel like I'm drowning. But I'm not sinking because Jesus is my Savior. And He is my foundation. And I am in the rock of ages. And He doesn't change. See, God doesn't change. He is my rock. He is my fortress. He is my deliverer, the Bible says. The fact is that Jesus is our sure, fast, and steadfast hope. He doesn't change. And I'm so thankful for that. Would you go back to Psalm 18 with me? Hopefully you kept a bookmarker there. If not, just get there if you can. I'd like for you to look at verse 31. Psalm 18, and look at verse 31. For who is God save the Lord? Or who is a rock save our God? Can I ask you something? Who is going to help you if Jesus doesn't? Who's going to be your rock when the storm comes if Jesus isn't that rock? What's going to keep you from falling and from faltering if it's not Jesus? David simply said, and who can help me and save me other than God? If you are saved, remember, then ye are complete in Him. Colossians 2:10 says that, and ye are complete in him. He is the all-sufficient one. Christ is our rock. He is our all in all. The fact is this, I want you to get this, and please just let this kind of be ingrained in your spirit and heart and your mind tonight. He is enough. He's enough. He is enough. Look at Psalm 18, and would you look at verse 2 once again? David said, "The Lord is my rock." But then he makes another statement along with that, and he said, "And my fortress." Would you say that? And my what? So he's our rock, and he's our what? All right. So Christ is our rock, but then secondly, I want you to get this: Christ is our fortress. Say, Pastor, you're real intelligent on this one, aren't you? Boy, these weren't real hard for you to write down, was it? Nope, comes right from the scripture. I love it when it's this made this so easy. And here's the thing: you're talking about rightly dividing God's word. When you stick right to the context and from the scripture, you don't have to come up with some fancy outline or come up with some antidote or try to alliterate everything to death. The fact is, sometimes it's just sufficient just to put exactly what God wrote. And that is that he's our fortress. He's our fortress. A fortress in Bible days was a place of defense. It was a place of safety. It was a place of security. Now, I don't know about you, but growing up, maybe you liked to play in the woods, maybe you didn't. I don't know many kids at some point in their life growing up didn't build a fort. Now, my son loves to build a fort, and every time we go somewhere, it doesn't even matter where we are. We can be on someone else's land, maybe visiting and just, or when we were on vacation, he was in the woods of this place that we're at, and we're looking out. Man, it was cold there. I'm like, I'm not going out there. I was drinking coffee and going, that's good, son. You know, it's cold out there. He's out there freezing. It was starting to snow, and he's out there in the woods watching him, and he's out there, and he's building a fort. And he's putting all these sticks up together, and he's putting all these sticks, and he's leaning them up, and it looks more like a teepee. And he builds it there, and he goes in there, and he kind of hides in there, and I go, you know I can still see you, right? You know, I'm looking at, I'm like, I can see you. And a fort is meant to be a defense. It's help. It's to be there to protect you. And David, when he says, he is my fortress, he doesn't mean it's something that the enemy can get through easily. It's not something that the arrows can come through the walls. It's not something that I can even be seen something behind. This fortress is something that protects me and I'm completely surrounded by. See, when you think of the word fortress, in that word fortress, you find the word fort. And a fortress would be a fort. That's what we would say today. We probably wouldn't use the word, hey, I'm going to go in the woods, Dad, and build a fortress. We probably wouldn't say that word. We would just say fort, and that's fine. But I kind of want to show you a few examples here on the screen. Here is a castle. This is the castle of Bodiam right here, and maybe you know about it, maybe you don't. And this is a 14th century moated castle that is in Robertsbridge, East Sussex, England. This was built in 1385, and man, this thing's incredible. And started in looking at, all I wanted was to bring you some examples, but in doing that, I got caught up in learning about this one. I thought this thing was awesome. And here's a picture of the inside of this. Look at this thing. And, of course, it's kind of been ransacked and deteriorated over the years and all that. But can you imagine being inside of that thing when it was complete and the protection of that? Man, you would have felt safe inside of that castle there. And I can only imagine what would have took place there and the battles and the things that would have been seen and took place. But that right there is a castle. It is a fortress. And David is wanting you to understand that when he is my fortress, man, I don't go outside the walls of the castle. Could you back up a slide there, Kat? I'm not sure who's back there running the slides. And you wouldn't go out there and kind of be in your boat as the enemy is shooting fiery darts and go, man, that looks really safe inside of there. He wouldn't go, man, that's some high walls. If the enemy's attacking and all of that, you wouldn't stay on the outside. You would do what? You'd get on the inside. And you would be protected. Why? That's just what you should do. And David is trying to remind us, listen, I want you to know when the fiery darts come, and they do, and when difficulties times come, and they always do for us, and for everybody it's at different times, and it's at different levels, and I get that. But the point is, all of us go through difficult times, but your safety is not in you. Your safety is not in, just listen to me now, it's not even in others. But we put all the emphasis in the wrong area. See, the next slide, the safety is on the inside. Man, I need to be covered by God's word. This is my safety. This is my fortress. This is not only where I learn about myself, but this is where I learn about my enemies, and this is where I learn about my protection that is found in God. He is my light, my strength, my song. In Christ alone. This is where we find this at. This is who we are. This is where we find our safety. Here's a picture of a castle. This is a castle at San Marco. This is one I'm pretty familiar with, or at least were for years. This is the fort in St. Augustine, Florida. This fort was constructed by the Spanish in 1672. Man, that's an incredible thing to tour. And the need was to fortify the tiny garrison. And if you've ever been to St. Augustine, Florida, Donnie, I think you and Sandra have been there. Man, it's small. That's not a big place. It's a small town. And it was built to protect this garrison town, this small town, as even early as 1586, and it was attacked by Sir Francis Drake, an Englishman who had a fleet of 20 ships and 2,000 men, sacked and burned the entire town, destroyed it. In 1668, just prior to them building this fort, the English pirate Robert Sears assaulted and plundered the huge settlement that was there. And at the time, a threat of English colonization in the north, it had significantly increased, and Queen Mariana of Spain authorized this construction of a stone fortification. And here's some more pictures. You can throw those up and of the wall. And if I'm not mistaken, I believe the walls are about 33 feet high. In the day, I think they were only like 24 feet high. They added to them over the years and all that. But you can kind of look inside, and the cannons that they've put back up there and rebuilt. And by the way, some of those cannons, they still fire today. And you can see where the men would have slept, and even where you can see where they'd have kept the prisoners and all that. My whole point is that the safety is not on the outside. The safety is on the inside. And I'm just wanting to kind of get you to have the picture of this, is that He is our fort. And it's great to tour it. Now, listen to the thing. We tour and leave. Isn't that a shame that we do that in our own life, spiritually speaking? We come to it and we leave. We come to it and we leave. You know what God's wanting us to do? God's wanting us to get in the safety, in the protection of Jesus Christ, and under His word, and under His guidance, and He wants us to stay there. God doesn't want you to leave the fort. There's protection here. And I'd like for you to look very quickly at Psalm 71. We have just a moment. Psalm 71, very quickly. And look at verse 3. Just by way of cross-reference. Psalm 71, verse 3, the Bible says, "Be thou my strong habitation, whereunto I may continually resort. Thou hast given commandment to save me, for thou art my rock and my fortress." See, Paul called believers today in this time of grace. Do you know that Paul calls us the the building of God. I love this next verse. It'll be on the screen. For we are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry. Ye are God's building. That is incredible to me. He also taught that God himself inhabits this building, this building that we are of God. God inhabits it according to Ephesians 2:22, in whom ye also are builded together for a habitation of God through the Spirit. David said that God was his strong habitation that he could continually resort in. He could continually reside in. But I want you to get this. Today, you don't have to flee to God as your resort. He actually indwells you in the person of Christ and his Spirit in you. I love that. You don't have to come to this building to find safety. You don't come to this building to find even God. When you exit the building, guess what? God does too. When we turn the lights off and the air off, God ain't here hanging out waiting for you to come back on Wednesday. When you leave, he leaves. And that's the beauty of all this. Colossians 1:27 says, Christ in you, the hope of glory. Christ in you. Where is my hope? My hope is found in Christ alone. My hope is found. He is my strength, my life, my song. Man, this cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. That is Christ. He is our rock, and he is our fortress. If Christ lives in you, you have constant 24 hours a day of security. How about Romans chapter 8? Come on, go there with me. Come on now. I don't hear either you have passed out or you just have decided to fade out just for a moment. Hang in there just for another minute or two. Romans chapter 8, verses 9 and 10. We're almost done for tonight. Romans chapter 8, verses 9 and 10. But ye are not in the flesh. Notice that. But ye are not in the flesh. Romans 8, 9 and 10. But in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. You are lost. There is no hope for you. He is not your rock. He sure isn't your fortress. But, verse 9, you're not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If so be the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. Paul is saying, look, you are either in Christ or out of Christ. Look at verse 10. And if Christ be in you, I love this, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. Anything good in me is Jesus. I want you to know that. I was dead before him. I was made alive by him. It is Jesus Christ. You received the Spirit the moment you believed on him, and you were sealed with the Spirit of promise, the Holy Spirit, according to Ephesians 4:30, until the day of redemption, until he returns. Here's the point, folks. You have security in Christ. There's no safer place to be. Christ is our fortress. When trouble comes, you don't have to, in your mind, flee to him or try to get his attention. God, hello, hello, are you there? You know, on the ball field, when you're playing basketball or playing football or some other sports or soccer and some other sport, you know what you find a lot of times it happens while you're on the field? You hear this statement, I'm open, I'm open. Hey, over here, I'm open, I'm open, I'm open. You know, we do that in our Christian life. But it's not right according to God's word. We have this mentality that, hey, God, hello, got to get his attention, got to do something or act a certain way, got to say a certain thing or whatever, or that we feel like we got to kind of perform or do something to get God's attention. Do you realize that you always have God's attention? He's always tuned in. He's always on the right station. You're not having to tune the thing in. You're not having to adjust the antenna. Christ lives in you. And by the way, He lives in you to walk with you through the problems and trials of your life. Man, that's good news for you and I. Why? Because He's our rock and He's our fortress. You are complete in Christ. He is all sufficient. And boy, I tell you what, this ought to get you excited, and this ought to help you, and this ought to encourage you, because He is ever present and He will always be with you. I'm so thankful that you can't leave Him. You can't lose Him. Today, someone came and barred my keys while I was in a meeting and in our church membership class, and someone had to borrow my keys to get in a certain room or for something. And you know, man, I came out of that room, and you know what? I was, man, where are my keys at? I want them keys to come back to me. I'm like, they've lost. I'll never see them again. You know, and I'm notoriously laying my keys down. And typically, wherever we go somewhere, the first thing I do, wherever we go, is I hand my keys and my wallet or my phone right to my wife. Why? Because I'm going to lay it down somewhere and I'm going to lose it. Now, if it's on me or if it's just me, I'm fine. But typically, if we're going to be somewhere and I'm around, I'm going to get distracted. I'm going to lay that stuff down. And all I can think about is I got to go find those keys. And so you know what? I talked to two. As soon as I got out of that class, I hit a person up and, man, go find my keys right now while I'm in the service. I won't be able to concentrate. I will not be able to pay attention while all this is going on if I know my keys are somewhere all on this campus. And then someone walked right up to me, right as I'm telling one guy to go and look for my keys. He's dangling my keys like this. And I'm like, give those to me right now. And sometimes, you know what we feel like we got to do? We feel like we got to get God's attention, or we got to go looking, and we got to go find where He's at. And we get so distracted. Do you know that you can't lose Him? He's right there with you, ever present with you, no matter where you are. The fortress of God, the fort of God, dwells and lives within you and I. And boy, that's good news for you and I. Christ is our rock, and He is our fortress. Would you say that, those two things? Christ is our rock, and Christ is our fortress. Ready to begin. Christ is our rock. And Christ is our... Well, that's what David said from Psalm 18:2, did he not? Man, the Lord is my rock and my fortress. You know what this says to us? That Christ is the all-sufficient one. He's enough. He is sufficient for you and I. This week, I have no idea what you may be bombarded with. Have no idea what phone call you'll take, email that will be sent, text that will come across to you. I have no way of knowing what type of discouragement may come to you this week. But I know that if Satan has his way, he will do all that he can to get that to you. Matter of fact, it may already be on the way. But I want you to be reminded of this one thing. Christ is my all-sufficient. In Him, I'll be just fine. And the storms around me may come, and the winds may blow, and it may seem it may be turbulent right now, and it may just seem that things are just uneven, and things are just kind of cattywampus, as they say. But I want you to know, in Christ alone, He is my rock. He is my fortress. As long as Christ is in me, and I am in Him, and by the way, that's forever. Everything's just going to be fine. Not that everything around me will be fine, but I will be okay. Won't mean that we won't be get battered and bruised along the way. But spiritually speaking, we are okay because God's okay. He is our strength, our hope, our song. Want you to know that. Take confidence tonight in knowing that Christ is your sufficiency. Let's pray. Father, we love You tonight. Thank You for Your word that we have received tonight. Thank You for the folks that came and stayed for our church membership class. Thank You for those non-folks that will be considering and possibly joining our church. in our family here within the next month. God, we love you and thank you for teaching us and sharing with us through David how you are our sufficiency. We take such confidence and hope, have such peace and strength in knowing that you are our rock and that you are our fortress. Thank you for being our all-sufficient one. Thank you for reminding us, according to Colossians 2:10, that we are complete in you. Our sufficiency is not of ourselves. It is of Jesus Christ, and we praise you for that. Thank you for the encouragement that we find in the Bible tonight. In Jesus' name I pray.